Well, I do have a message. You know, Thanksgiving, and a lot of times during Thanksgiving, the women in the house are kind of the ones that kind of set everything up, right? I mean, maybe some of you men do. I actually have one of my best friends is a guy, and we've been friends since high school. You go, what? She has a guy best friend. Well, he's married to my best friend, too. So just so you know, there's nothing there. But he's just like this crazy guy who decorates the house, who like cooks the meals. And I'm just like, who are you? You know, like he's like pushing his wife to like, come on, let's decorate. She's like, all right. You know, so it is amazing. So I will not just go ahead and put that in a category of women only. There are some men out there that love to decorate. Where's Elijah? Because Elijah, that man can decorate. You know, Pastor Elijah, Reverend Elijah, he has the whole back already decorated, and that was not a woman that had any hand in that. And so I just do believe that God gives us Thanksgiving, though, as something special. The holiday seasons, you know, the world wants to make them about turkeys and family and Thanksgiving, but you know what? I believe that all of them are for Jesus. You see, we wouldn't be here if it weren't for him. I know for me, I would be busted and broken, and who knows where I would be at this point. So I am so grateful for my salvation. I am so grateful that God saved me and redeemed me, forgave me, restored me, showed me mercy. And I think that in this Thanksgiving season, that it's the least we can do to just stop and take a deep breath. No matter how much you have people coming over and the meals and the tables have to be set and the candles have to be lit and you had to put a smile on your face when you're totally freaking out inside because you barely took a shower and they're all showing up at the door. You take a deep breath and you go, you know what, God, I gotta stop. Because this is a season of thanks and giving. And Thanksgiving is such a special time to me. It's actually one of my favorite holidays besides Christmas, because Christmas is the best time of the year. But Thanksgiving is so beautiful. And there's a lady in the Bible that just began to just minister to my heart this season. And her name is Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was a woman who had some issues. This woman had seven demons. Now, you know, when you are actually demon-possessed, you got some issues. There are some things attached to that. There were some paths that she had taken. There were some situations that she ran into in order for these things to come to play. So Mary Magdalene is a woman who was hurting. She's a woman who needed deliverance. She's a woman who was bound and needed freedom. She was a woman who was desperate for salvation. And she met someone, and his name was Jesus. And when she came into the presence of Jesus, he casted the demons out of her. And do you know what happened to her from that point on? She was a grateful and a thankful woman. In fact, because of Mary Magdalene's heart of gratitude, she was the one behind the scenes everywhere Jesus was. When he went and he did what he needed to do with his disciples, guess who was there? Mary Magdalene in the background, taking care of him and his disciples, providing for them. It said that she possibly was wealthy because she had a team of women that would follow and take care of him. But you see, would that have been Mary Magdalene's destiny if she would not have been grateful? Would that have been her call? And would she have found her completeness? Would she have known the goodness of God if it weren't for that thankful and grateful heart? You see, if she would not have been thankful and grateful and followed after the one that freed her and redeemed her and filled up all of that void and that emptiness with Jesus, those demons would have come back and she would have been a mess. But instead of that, Mary Magdalene pressed on. She followed after the heart of God. She sought what was important to Jesus. Therefore, she was important to him. You see, here's this woman, Mary Magdalene, as Jesus was going to hell to get the keys of sin and death, and he had not yet ascended into heaven. He took a stop here on earth, and guess who he allowed to see him? Mary Magdalene. He said, "Do not touch me, for I have yet not ascended." But I thought, whoa, what an intimacy. What a trust. What a forgiveness from the Father. You see, it wasn't what she had done. It wasn't where she had been. He didn't sit there and go, "Oh, I know your past. Oh, I know where you've been." No, Mary Magdalene was special to him. and she was thankful, and she was grateful, and she was a servant, and she began to pull those things out inside of her that maybe she never knew was there, all because she stopped and she said, oh, I'm grateful. In fact, I'm so grateful, I'm going to serve you for the rest of my life. And I don't know about you, but when I met Jesus, oh, when I saw him face to face, when he saved me from hell, I could have and should have been dead. I look at the face of Jesus when I wake up in the morning. I say, oh, good morning, Father God. I'm so thankful today. You see, when we wake up bitter and angry and frustrated, and the day's worries and the day's stresses and the day's displeasures want to steal our little victories. You see, God is bigger than all of it. And when those things come at us, just like Mary Magdalene, we have so much to be grateful for. We have so much to look forward to. We have so much to run after. And I believe that God has a message for us in this Thanksgiving season, that he's seeking for the hearts that are thankful. He wants to connect for hearts that are thankful. God wants to be intimate with thankful and grateful hearts. He wants to have that alone time with a heart that seeks him. He wants to have those moments with just him and you, in attitude, in a surrender, in a humility, in a humble heart, speaks great volumes to God. And in a heart of thankfulness, we can learn so much. You see, this woman was known for being horrible. She was known as demon-possessed. She was known as crazy. Have you ever come across somebody talking to themselves, walking down the street? What are you thinking? You're looking and you're going, I don't know if everything's... I'm sure she was judged. I'm sure she was an outcast. But when she met Jesus, he brought her in, he scooped her in, and he said, oh, but I got you, daughter. And just as he did for her, he is not a respecter of persons. And God wants us to have a heart of thankfulness for what it is that he is doing for us. And sometimes it's easy for us, me very much so included, to forget what he's done. Have you ever been praying for something like over and over and over again? Oh, God, you know, would you just do this, do that, do this? And then you get it and it's almost like, oh, yeah, I forgot to thank God for that. See, I think that Mary Magdalene was so aware of every step Jesus took that she went after it. And then she was grateful. And oh, there, oh, he's going over here. I want to be where he's at. Oh, I'm just so thankful for what he's done. Maybe he's going to do it for somebody else. And then they can see the freedom and they can know the love and they can see his passion. You see, when we have been set free, redeemed, and loved, there is something that comes out of us, and automatically a heart of thankfulness for salvation rings. And I believe it rings in Jesus' ears, and it's a beautiful sound. There's this glass. I have this glass. And let's say this glass represents Jesus, okay? And the water inside the glass, you know that question, do you see a glass half empty or do you see a glass half full? That's really not the question, because if everything in this glass represents your life, are you thankful for it being half empty? Are you thankful for it being half full? You know, oh, well, I didn't get everything I wanted. And, you know, that job got passed me by. And that boss didn't see me the way I think I should have been seen. And, you know, how about you're thankful to have a job? How about, well, you know, that thing didn't work out in my house and I'm disappointed, I'm discouraged because I prayed and it didn't come through. Well, maybe God has something around the corner that you didn't know about. So are you seeing the glass half empty or half full is not really the question. Because remember, the glass represents Jesus. And you know what we need to be thankful for? We need to be thankful for the glass and not the life inside of it, but the glass that holds the life together, that keeps us in place, that surrounds us and that fills us and equips us. You see, Jesus is our life source. And Jesus has a plan and a purpose for each and every single one of us. And when we have a grateful and when we have a thankful heart, what does that do then? How does that that connect us? Where does that take us with God? Maybe you've been a little bitter. Maybe you're a little mad. Listen, Pastor Jess got mad on Thursday night with the team up here. And then I was like, okay, God, please forgive me. So I know moments of mad. We're human. But listen to me. Don't stay bitter in that mad. Don't stay ungrateful in that mad. Have your moment, but then move on and begin to let God do a new thing inside of you. Listen to me. God looks at our hearts and he wants us to examine ourselves because he wants us to be grateful and thankful. And when we're angry and we're bitter, when we're unforgiving and when we're malice towards each other, I don't believe that heaven rings like, oh, let me pay attention. Have you ever been around someone who's just kind of always negative? You know, my dad always says I'm allergic to negative. And honestly, sometimes I catch myself and I'm like, I'm allergic to myself. And you know, I do believe that that is the first thing that will push and pull apart. Ugh, you're not listening, daughter. You know better than that, daughter. What are you doing? Why are you letting unforgiveness? Why are you letting bitterness? Why are you letting criticism? Why are you being so critical of everybody? Stop it. Stop it. And I believe God has a plan for that. How do we catch the heart of a thankful heart? How do we catch a thankful heart? How do we find out what God wants from us? How do we run from these things? A thankful heart will bring so many good things into our lives, but yet we cling to sometimes the negative. And God says, I don't want you as the body of Christ to live in negativity, but I want you to run in freedom. I want you to live in expand greatness. I want you to have bigger capacities and larger purposes. I want you to dream dreams and see visions. I want you to go further and farther. But when you're bitter and you're angry and you're unforgiving, it will stop you in your tracks, and I cannot help you there. You see, God says a heart of thankfulness, number one, it leads us freedom from bitterness. I don't know about you, but I do not want to be bound by bitterness. A bitter person just looks like a sourpuss. Have you ever, you know, sucked on lemons? You ever, you know, they tuck their arms in and they slouch in their seats and they're just unhappy about everything. You may say, well, I never said anything, yeah, but your body language says it all. And see, God is watching all of it. God is seeing all of it, and he says, if you just thank me for a moment, if you just stop for a second and thank me for what it is that I've put in your hand, the bitterness, the malice, and the anger will no longer have place. And faith will begin to arise in your heart. Encouragement will begin to arise in your heart. Joy will begin to be your strength. Because God is the one who's the answer for all of this. A critical spirit is just not something God wants from any of his children. It's just something that is an off-putting thing. You know, when you're critical, have you ever been around a critical person? You're like, seriously, is anything good in your life? Do you ever see anything good about anything in life? I mean, it is a really hard conversation to have with people. And God says, stop. Can you speak a thankful life? Can you speak a good life? Can you speak a faith-filled life? Can you do something beyond what it is you feel? Put your flesh down, make it die, and get into faith and do what it is I've asked of you to do as the daughter and the son of the Most High God. In Ephesians 4:3, it says, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put from you with all malice. Listen, we all get there. But this Thanksgiving season, let's really strive to have hearts of thankfulness. And when the bitterness and the anger and the malice and all of that, and believe me, I'm preaching to myself too, happens, remember to put it away, to shut it, to put it away, tuck it away and say, I'm not going there. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to say it. I'm not going to be bitter. I'm not going to be unforgiving. Go get with God and go check your heart. And when I know that I get with the Lord and I'm sitting there alone with him, have your alone time with God. Make that important. When you know your heart is just kind of like, oh, that person at work, and oh, my boss, or oh, my family members, and they're all coming over for Thanksgiving, great. Listen, that's when we have to say, what is this, God? What's going on in here? Because I'm a daughter of God, and I shouldn't be feeling this way. And I'm a son of God, and I should not be acting this way. Lord, what is this? And if we begin to thank you, God, for my family, even though I don't understand them. Thank you, God, for my job, even though I don't know why it's coming and happening the way things are. Lord, thank you that those bills are going to get paid. And thank you, God, that I have parents. And thank you, God, that I have children, even though they're driving me crazy. Lord, thank you for them. And begin to speak things that you don't see into existence. Begin to speak those beautiful dreams and those beautiful visions over your life. Put aside malice, put aside anger, put aside those things. God is requiring more of us as full-time ministers of the gospel of Jesus. He says, you're better than that. Don't go there. Get alone with God. There's freedom from bitterness. There's freedom from anger. 1 Peter 5:7 says, casting all of our cares upon him, for he cares. Those alone times, those prayer times, those in the closet times, maybe you're driving in the car times, maybe you're just praying quietly while everybody's crazy around you times. Listen, cast it off. Lord, I give it to you. I'm not going to receive it. I'm not going to let it ruin my day. I'm not going to let it ruin my words. I'm not going to let it ruin my thoughts. I'm not going to let it ruin the ideas that you've given me. I'm going to stay on the path that you've led me on, and that's where I'm staying, God, and I'm thankful for what it is you're doing. I'm thankful for where you're taking me. I'm thankful for what my future holds, and that is where you have to talk yourself back into Thanksgiving sometimes. We do. We have to remind ourselves of the good things. We have to sit on the blessings. Because sometimes it's easy to forget. Sometimes it's easy to compare. Oh, so-and-so, and, you know, but I'm not that good. You know, do not compare. Pastor Eleanor Becker is probably one of the wisest people I know. And that woman, she just says things sometimes. And she said to me one day, well, don't compare yourself with somebody else. Because then you're going to get smaller, and that's not what God wants. And don't compare yourself with them, because then they get smaller if you puff yourself up. You see, all of this is a flesh thing. All of this is us fighting the flesh until we get to go and be home with Jesus, and we get to just walk and dance in his goodness and his freedom. But listen, we can overcome bitterness and malice and anger and frustration and all of those things that want to overtake our day by just having a heart of thankfulness. And that is what God is asking. There were two psychologists named Robert Empson and Michael McLeod. And they had done some research on gratitude. And so they broke three groups up. One group was supposed to write everything that they were grateful for that had happened to them during the week. The next group wrote about daily irritations and the things that displeased them. And the third group wrote about the events that affected them. Now, that was either good or bad. They didn't have to put an emphasis on any of those events. Out of all three of these groups, after 10 weeks, those who wrote about gratitude were more optimistic, and they felt better about their lives. They were also exercised more, and there were fewer visits to the doctors, and they focused on not sources of aggravation. When things came against them, they just didn't bug them. They just were like, whatever. They let water slide off their back, well, like water off a duck's back. Is that the same? And that's what they did, because they focused on the good for those 10 weeks instead of the negative for those 10 weeks, instead of the, well, maybe good and bad, whatever. You see, it's all about our attitudes. And because we are children of God, we cannot get away with as much as probably an unsaved person in the eyes of God. Listen to me. You are accountable for your actions. There is a new requirement on you as the son and daughter of the Most High God. He's asking us to come up a level. He's asking us to die to ourselves. He's asking us to become servants in his kingdom. He's asking us to give of ourselves, to surrender ourselves. That's not going to come easy. Those tests are not fun. Pastor Luke talked about the test a few weeks ago. But listen to me, when the anger and the madness and the unforgiveness and the irritation, you can feel yourself getting anxious on the inside, stop. Back away and say, I need to pray. And go be with God and thank him for the good things. Thank him for the good situations. Thank him for what it is he's gonna do. And you're just combating hell with God's goodness, and it will be defeated, and you will see victory in it because there is freedom in it. When we have thankful hearts, the second thing it does is it just unlocks awesome favor. I don't know about you, but I love the favor of God on my life. When it's locked up, it is not a fun place to be. But when there's a favor of God on my life, it's like I can walk anywhere and it opens up. It just, you knock on a door and it opens. Oh, hi, how are you? I put my hand to something and it just like flowers grow everywhere I touch. I'm kidding. But the favor of God on our lives is something so amazing. And I believe a grateful and a thankful heart, a heart that gets in a routine of thanking God for what it is he's doing, what he's gonna do, even when we don't see it, it begins to open up favor. Here was Mary Magdalene. That woman had favor on her life. She had the attention of Jesus. She was in an intimate relationship with him where he trusted her. He trusted her. She saw and heard conversations that not everybody would get to see or hear. She got to be in those corners where they would, where the disciples would talk and he would teach and she would serve them and she would take care of them. And he trusted her to have ears to hear. He trusted her. He knew that her thankful heart was special, and he showed favor towards her. You know, in Psalms 90, 17, go ahead and turn there. I'm gonna drink my water. Let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. What is it in your hand? What has God put in your hand? What has he asked you to do? What is it that he's given you? What gifts and talents do you have? What is the people that you're surrounded with? You see, the people you're surrounded with, the gifts and talents that you have, the things that God has put in your hand, those are all assets for the kingdom of God. Those are all heart tests for you. What are you doing with what's in your hand? Because when we open our hands and we say, here we go, God, this is all I've got. I don't have much, but maybe it's beautiful to you. And God, I thank you for what it is I do have. I thank you, God, for the house, the roof over my head. I thank you, God, that I have a car to drive. I thank you, God, that I have a job to go to. I thank you, God, that I have a friend that loves me or a husband or children or whatever it is that's in your world. I thank you, God, for that. And Lord, because of that, I'm going to open my home up this Thanksgiving. And because of that, God, I'm gonna make something special for these people. Or because of that, God, I'm going to go and serve the church because they've been such a blessing to me. Because of that, God, I'm going to use the gifts and the talents that you've given me. Maybe you're a business savvy person. God has a business for you. And he's waiting for you to get your heart aligned and an attitude of thankfulness because he wants to unlock favor on you. And he's waiting for that heart to be in a place of gratitude so that it won't be about you, but it will only be about him. Because see, everything we put our hand to and everything we open our hand to and everything we do to do the work for the ministry, God wants to pour favor on it. He wants to pour blessing on it. He wants to, every word that comes out of your mouth, let it be anointed by God. Everything that you see, Lord, just I pray in the name of Jesus for that man walking down the street. You see, you are a living testimony of Jesus. And he wants to pour favor out on you. And he says, I need you to line up your heart in an attitude of gratefulness because I got a whole bunch of favor to drop down your way. I got a whole bunch of goodness to just expand on you. I've got something greater than what you can think in your mind. I've got new paths for you to walk down. I have new things for you to do. But I'm waiting for your heart to line up in a place of gratitude and thankfulness. You see, God has something amazing. I have three crazy, wonderful, amazing children. And my kids don't ask for much, but when they do, if they came up to me and they said, you know, Mom, I need this, and like did the whole like, and expected that from me. Just give me money because I need to go. Have you ever had those moments with your children, especially the teenagers? Look, can I get $10 because me and my friends, you know, it's like, psh. How about please, Mom? Can I please have this? And thank you, Mom. That would be nice. You see, you're not going to just go ahead and pour out all this blessing on your kids when they're being rude and when they're being ungrateful and when they're being expectant. Sometimes I wonder how we approach the throne. God, you need to. God, I need you to do this. God, you need to do that. You need to do that. You need to show up, God. You need to change their heart, God. You need to do this. And God's going, you need to check yourself first. Because until you do, I'm not going to pour out any favor on you. Because your heart is wrong. It's not thankful. It's not grateful. You just expect me. I'm not your piggy bank. You see, when my children come to me, though, and they're like, hey, Mom, I was wondering if maybe you could do this for me. And I know that you're really busy, but if you do, you know, that would be really awesome. But if you don't, it's fine. I'm totally okay with it. It's good. You know what I'm going to do? Absolutely. What do you need? When do you need me to take you? What do you need me to do? Do you need any money for that? Whose party is it? Let's buy them a gift. You see what I'm saying? I'm just going to pour it all out on them. Because there was such a humble heart. There was such a grateful heart. There was such a beautiful love and respect for me as the parent that they know I work hard in order to make that happen for them. They know that that's going to take time out of my day to do what it is that they need to do. My kids just ended soccer season, and boy, was that a doozy. There were two playing. We had two practices. We had two games. Pastor Jess works a lot. And I was just like, there were moments where I was like, I think I'm going to pass out. And at the end of this season, we were driving home. My one son, he didn't win one game. Now listen, I'm very competitive. So I was the parent on the side, like heating up, you know? And every time my kid would get off the field, he's like, I just need a new team. And I'm like, seriously? That's not the answer, dude. Like, you need to work together as a team. You guys aren't team playing. But finally, the last game, they learn how to become team players, you know? It's like, So anyways, so he gets off the field and he just starts to cry because he said in the car on the way to the game, God, I just pray that I can win one game. I just want to win one game this season. And he just cried and my heart broke. I could just see him running off the field and he like slowly like fell apart, you know. And I just hugged him and I said, Bubba, it's okay. It doesn't make you any better or worse. You tried your best. You played hard today. You, like, fell and rolled and blocked every ball. Like, they didn't win by nothing. They won by 1 point. So the whole game, they did nothing but, like, you blocked them the whole time. So don't beat yourself up over that. You see, Bubba, why don't we go do something special for you today so that you know that it wasn't a waste? Why don't we just go ahead and be together? And we played together that day, and I loved on him. And then when Dad came home, he cried to Dad, too. And, you know, he's just a very sensitive kid. He's the middle child. So if you're a middle child, you're awesome. I think every woman should marry a middle child. And he's just, like, just so in touch with everything. And then at the end of the day, he told me, Mom, I'm grateful I had that soccer team because, you know what, they were really nice kids. And one kid was mean to the other team this week. And I told him, you know what? They played good, and we should give them high fives. We shouldn't call them stupid because the other kid called them stupid. You see, that to me is a reward. That to me is the favor of God that my son was able to catch that on a soccer field and go, I don't want nothing to do with that. I want to be in the presence of God. I want to stay lined up with God. And maybe I didn't win this game. Doesn't mean God didn't answer my prayers. It means that I'm just going to be stronger in the outcome of it. And I told him, next year, you watch, you win every game, buddy. You know, because God is good. And he cares about the little things. And he wants to pour favor on us because he loves us deeply. You see, just one touch of God's favor can put us 20 miles down the road. Joel Osteen said that. Just one touch of God's favor would take us 20 miles down the road. Listen, we need the favor of God in our lives, in our homes, in our finances, in our marriages. The last one is a thankful and a grateful heart brings us a destiny. Mary Magdalene had a new destiny when she met up with Jesus. When she was thankful, her path changed. She was no longer going to be this crazy woman who would probably die that way, but she was a free woman who had purpose, who had destiny, who had position, who had acceptability, who had just everything. She had the presence and the audience of the king of the world. I mean, come on, I don't think it could get any better than that. Quite a destiny. Did you know you have the same destiny as Mary Magdalene? That you have an audience with the king of the world. You have the ability to approach the throne room. And he says, oh, what do you need? Come here, my child, because I love you. Oh, you don't know where your path is and what your destiny is. Listen to me. Start thanking God that he's going to reveal it to you. Start thanking God for wherever you're at and whatever path we're on, that he's going to take us to that next step. He's going to take us to that next level. You might be in a transition period of time, and it's uncomfortable, and you don't know where your spot is. You don't know how to fit in. But listen to me. God says, it's not the end. Your destiny is still ahead of you. I have more things for you. I have new plans to do. I have new paths to go. I just need you to get an attitude of thankfulness, because when you thank me for it, I'm going to begin to pour out favor on you. And then you're going to walk right into your destiny, just like Mary Magdalene did. The word of God is rich. It's a beautiful and powerful thing. In Psalms 24, it says, may he grant you according to your heart's desires and fulfill all of your purpose. Listen, he's on your team. He's your cheerleader. He thinks you can do it. He knows that you are more than a conqueror because he's already gone before us. He says, take a hold of what it is that you want, your heart's desires, he's on board with. Colossians 3:5 says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called into one body, and be thankful. My favorite verse, Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. It will bring destiny. A thankful heart will free us from bitterness. So this Thanksgiving, don't get bitter about making the meal all by yourself or then cleaning it up all by yourself. This Thanksgiving, don't get mad about the cousin who gossiped about you and told lies on you. Just welcome him in and love on him. Keep him at a distance, because you don't want to give him too much information. But, you know, just love on him from a distance. Guard your heart. This Thanksgiving, thank God every day for his goodness, for his faithfulness, for his mercy, for his grace, for salvation, for whatever it is that you have in your hand. Do it beautifully. This Thanksgiving, let's have a heart of freedom from bitterness. Let's have favor poured out upon us. Oh, that those dollars will spend like $10,000. That Christmas will not put us in the hole, but Christmas will be a blessing, and we can be generous and give to others and go beyond ourselves and bless people outside of our borders and beyond our boundaries. Let's be generous this season, because the favor of God is on us. And then walk into your destiny. Thank God for what it is he has in your hand, your purpose, your call. What is it, God? What do you need me to do, Lord? What is it you have for me? And last but not least, let's remember the victories. Let's remember the victories. There's a pastor that I respect, and I was listening to his story today, so I'm going to tell it to you in case you didn't hear it. And he said he was walking into a friend's house, and his friend was like this crazy fisherman. I mean, he fished every single day. He was a really incredible fisherman. And as he's walking through the house, he had these amazing fish mounted on his walls. And he's going down and he's showing him all the different fish. Oh, this is shark so-and-so. This is marlin so-and-so, da-da-da-da. And he's like, wow. And he says, every single one of these are trophies and victories. And I've caught many little fish and they've fed me and they've taken care of me. But I want to put up the ones that I worked hard for. The ones that took me somewhere, the ones that made it worth it. Listen, what are your trophies? What are your victories? Put them in front of you. Place them on a wall. Be amazingly loud about how amazing your God is. What is it in your life that you've had victory over? Have you conquered cancer? Have you won the battle for your marriage? Have you been not defeated when you were broke down, busted, and disgusted? When it looked like there was nothing, did God come through? And did he take you out of the miry pit? When you needed a house, did he provide? When you needed something as simple as a refrigerator, did he take care of you? You see, you have to remember and put those things in front of you. So when all of the negative and, oh, look at how bad things are. Oh, look at, you can keep your eyes focused and you can go, oh, no, look at that one. Oh, and that one and that one and that. No, I'm going to be just fine. I'm going to be just fine because I have a good God. He's going to provide for me. He's going to take care of me. And right now this may look bleak, but he knows my number. He knows where I'm going and he knows what I need. So let's remember the victories this Thanksgiving. When you're sitting around your tables, do this for me. I don't know. Some of you, I've heard some of the women say, well, we don't have a table. We just, everybody sits everywhere. And I was like, wow, that's like a big full house of people. But you know what? There has to be a moment where I challenge you this Thanksgiving to be a godly person. Maybe you are surrounded by ungodly people in your homes. Maybe your family's not saved and you're the only one saved. Listen to me. You are a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm asking you to be bold and to go public with your faith this Thanksgiving season. Now, I'm not saying shove it down their throats, but what I am saying is speak it out of your mouth. You know, I'm thankful this Thanksgiving because God has blessed me this year. God has provided for me this year. I'm thankful because he met my needs this year. Can I pray for Thanksgiving dinner? What? Yep, I want to pray for Thanksgiving dinner this year. You see, go outside of your box. Get outside your comfort zone. Take that extra step because I believe heaven is watching and it's standing at attention and it's going, so what are you going to do, son and daughter? You going to act like the rest of them like you always have? Are you going to be saved? Are you going to be called? Are you going to live worthy? He is asking us to take a step up and to be the full-time ministers he's asked us to be. And let's pray. Dear God, we just love you. And Lord, we humble ourselves right now. And God, we thank you for who you are, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you, God, for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And Lord, I ask and I pray for every home in this house represented. Lord, I pray that as they go out this Thanksgiving, that God, that there would be salvation in their homes. Lord, I pray, God, that there would be just a beautiful presence of the Holy Spirit that flows everywhere they walk. Lord, I pray for favor, God, during these hard times and these seasons, God, to be with family or maybe somebody's lost a loved one during this season. God, comfort their hearts. Lord, be with them deeply and intimately. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would begin to hear our hearts as thankful people. Just thank God right now. Just take a moment in your own time to be with God. Thank him for what it is that he's put in your hand. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, we just seal that. And we just love you. God, we just thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to talk to some of you tonight. Maybe you came in here and somebody invited you and you're just not quite sure how you got here or why you're here. But I believe God has divine appointments for each and every one of us. That destiny that we talked about, that path, I believe he has it for you and for me. And I believe God wants to speak to you right now. So could I have everyone stay seated? There may be a time in your life that is hard. It might be a time in your life where it's easy. But listen to me. We are not promised tomorrow. If you were to walk out of this room, I want to ask you a few questions. And I want you to look at your heart and see your life and see where you would end up and follow me through this. If you were to leave this room tonight and you were to die in a car accident, where would you end up? Would you end up in heaven or would you end up in hell? And you said, well, I hope I would end up in heaven. Well, the thing about it is that you can't hope your way into heaven. But Jesus says that he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. And that no man comes before the Father except by him. And Jesus died on the cross for our sins. When he was crucified for our sins, his blood washed away, and he was the sacrificed lamb for us so that we could love him and follow him and be free from sin. He wants that for you tonight. And maybe you did not know that there was a God in heaven who gave so much for you, but he wants you to know he loves you and he wants an intimate relationship with you, just like Mary Magdalene had when she met Jesus. Everything changed. And I believe tonight is your night. You're not here by chance. You can't hope your way into heaven. You can't think your way into heaven. You can't just get to heaven because, you know, all roads lead to heaven is what the world tells us. Listen, God, many people call God. That Allah was the one that they ran into the World Trade Centers for. That's not God. Jesus is the only and the one true God, the one who loved you, who knew you and formed you in your mother's womb, the one who longs for you and deeply wants to have an intimate relationship with you. And he's saying to you tonight, would you answer the call? Would you come be with me? I want to have a relationship. The world talks about being born again, and they make fun of it on TV all the time. They make fun of Christians all the time because they don't understand the depth of this intimate relationship that we talked about tonight. But being born again is actually an amazing thing. You say, well, I don't quite understand that. Well, there was a man by the name of Nicodemus in the Bible, and he didn't quite understand it either. He was talking to Jesus, and he said, I don't get it. How can I be born again? I can't get back into my mother's womb and be born again. And Jesus, no, you're not getting it, Nicodemus. What is born of flesh is flesh, but what is born of spirit is spirit. And when you ask Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, you have now connected with him. He now lives inside of you, and you now are no longer a sinner, but you have a new life, you have a new destiny, and you have a new purpose and a new path. You have a new future, and you are a new creation in Christ. You say, well, there was a time, maybe when I was in junior high, and I remember going to camp or a conference, and I raised my hand because I wanted to know this God, and this God was amazing. I was so excited about it, but I never really followed up. Well, then you know what? Tonight, I want to give you the opportunity to make sure, because you are not promised tomorrow. Remember, we talked about that. You're not promised tomorrow. So you need to make sure tonight that you're right with God. Maybe there was a time in your life where you were just on fire, and then now you just kind of come here and there, and you're just not really serving God, and you're kind of doing more of your own thing instead of God's thing. In Revelation, it says, you're either hot or you're cold, but when you're lukewarm, that he will vomit you from his mouth. You go, whoa, that is intense. He's an intense God because he's passionate about you, because he gave his life for you, because you're so valuable that he doesn't play games, that he wants to connect with you, he wants to love you, and he wants to be a part of our world. So, if you've maybe thought, oh, well, I hope maybe I'll make it because my parents took me to church my whole life. Well, you don't just get to heaven because you go to church. You could come here and sit in our services every week. You could hold Pastor Dan's Bible. You can come up and sing with Elijah. But it wouldn't make you saved. The only way you can get to heaven is by asking Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life. Confess with your mouth. Jesus said that if you confess me before men, then I will confess you before my Father. But if you deny me before men, then I will deny you before my Father. You see, he wants that intimacy. He wants that relationship. So tonight I'm going to give you an opportunity, and this is going to be the best part of your whole entire life, because this is a new beginning. This is a new chapter. This is a new destiny for you. If you at one time was serving God and you hadn't served God any longer, I want you to raise your hand and make sure tonight, get your life right. If you've been lukewarm, stop being lukewarm. Stop riding the fence. Get right with God and say, yes, I want you, Jesus. I don't want to play games any longer. Tonight's your night. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. If you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life, and you want to meet this Jesus, the one that changed Mary Magdalene's life, the one that changed our lives, the one that loves you and saved you and died on a cross for you. I'm talking to you tonight, and this is how it's going to work. I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, and I'm going to bam my hand on the mic like that. And when I do that, I want you to raise your hand. You're like, oh no, she wants me to do this in front of everyone. Remember what we talked about. If you confess me before God, then he will confess you before his Father. You can do this. We're all here cheering you on. We're all really excited about your new future and your destiny. You have a new family to be a part of here. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to raise your hand. So on the count of three, if you've never asked Jesus to come into your heart, I want you to raise your hand. If you've never, ever done that, it is your time tonight. Do not waste time. If your heart is like going crazy and you're like, oh man, I just can't wait for her to stop talking. Listen, I'm talking to you. The Holy Spirit wants to have an awesome relationship with you, because you're so special to him. If you've been lukewarm, I'm talking to you. On the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. If you've been hoping and thinking and maybe in your way into heaven, that's not going to work. You need to get right. You need to make sure tonight. Do not walk out of here because you are not promised. On the count of three. 1, 2, 3. Raise your hand. 1. It is hard to see up here, Pastor Dan. You're right. Anybody in the family rooms? Do not walk out of here tonight not right with God. Anybody else? 1. You're all right with God. You can walk out of here, and if you were to die tonight, you're good. 2. Thank you. Thank you. Don't leave here tonight not making it right with the Lord. I'm going to sweep the room one more time. Anybody else? I'll wait for you. You're too important to not wait. There's more. You're saying, oh man, I wish you would just close it up. I'm good. Listen, I remember sitting in those seats and fighting it. Like, God, that means my life's going to have to change. That means I'm going to have to, like, do things differently. You know what the coolest part of it was? My life changed for so much better. That the things that I did differently came so much easier. That life just began to have purpose when I was so broken. He wants that for you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, hallelujah. I still believe that two people is so amazing to God. And so this is what we're going to do. The Bible says that he rejoices over one. So heaven is totally rocking out tonight because two of you said, I want to do this. I want to make it right with God. I want to just ask Jesus to come into my heart. So this is what we're going to do. We're all going to stand up, and we're all going to, those of you that need to come forward and ask Jesus to come into your heart, I'm asking you to come forward, grab your friends and your purses and your Bibles and whatever you need and come on down. I'd love to shake your hand and get to know you. Do not walk out right now. Do not walk out. You're discouraging people from coming forward. You don't get saved by just raising your hand. You need to come forward and we'll pray with you. your first step to boldness. Come on. Well, those of you, what a shame. What a shame. Let me say this. You play games with God, He's serious. He wants your heart. He wants your life. He gave everything for it. If that's you, come forward. Do not play games. You're not promised tomorrow. You're not promised tomorrow. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you. It's a new future. Proud of you guys. That's a bold move, but you know it takes boldness to serve God. And so what we're gonna do is, this is Pastor Joel, and he's pretty awesome, okay? And I'm weird. I'm kind of that weird girl around the campus with a big mouth, but he is just awesome, okay? Pastor Joel is fun, and he is just an amazing man of God. And what he's gonna do is, he's gonna lead you in a prayer to ask Jesus to come into your heart and be the Lord and Savior of your life. Because you don't get saved by just coming forward and raising your hand, but you get saved by asking him to come into your heart. And tonight, you have a new destiny. Tonight is a new future for you guys. Tonight, you have a new hope. And tonight, God has new dreams to plant inside of your hearts. Okay, so what we're going to do, as you turn that way, there's also going to be an SBT that will help you along the way. We love you. God bless you. Now, Rock Church, how many of you call this your home? All right. How many of you are checking us out? Dang it, you came tonight. You should wait for Pastor Dan. Come back and hear him and hear Pastor Luke, because I'm the weirdo, okay? But God has something for us at this church. I believe God is going to build some new things inside of us. I believe that God has something for the Inland Empire. He wants to take us to new levels. He wants to take us to new places and new dreams. But listen to me. I can't do that alone. And I want you to do me a favor. This holiday season, I want you to go public with your faith. This holiday season, I want you to be full-time ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You sit in these seats and you get the messages. Listen to me. Trust God that He'll speak through you to say what you need to say wherever you are and whatever you're doing. So when you're at the store and you're going through the same cashier's checkout stand, guess what? They recognize you. Start talking to them. How you doing? How's your Thanksgiving? Da, da, da. Oh, yeah, you know, we just came from church. You see, open up the door. Begin to talk. Ask them about their lives. Act interested. Get off your phones and look up for a second. And look in the eyes of somebody this week. Say, how are you doing? Begin to be a full-time minister. Begin to realize that your hands and your feet are not your own, but they're Jesus's, and He has something for us. I don't want to sit here on Sunday nights and be okay with two salvations, because there's a lost world out there. There's a lost and dying world. Just turn on the news. The devil's mad. And he's trying to take as many people with him to hell as he can. And I need you guys to link up with us. And if you bring them, there will be an altar call. And if you bring them, they'll get saved. And if you invite them, I believe that'll unlock something in their hearts that maybe that they've been waiting for someone just to invite them. So you guys promise me that you're going to do your job? Because this is a call to action. Okay? So we're just not going to come and receive and sit and do nothing with our Christian faith. But we're going to do something. We're going to go public. We're going to put our hands to the plow. We're going to make God's name famous. So there is a booth out back that talks about, like, Rock Life, Rock Church, and it has these little cards on it. And that's a tool for you. Put them in your purse. Put them in your wallets. So when you're at the gas station, when you're getting your car fixed, when you're at the doctor's office, remember, you are a full-time minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And remember, everything you do is ordained by God. And so then, what is it, God? What mission do you have me on today? and ask God that. And then that's a tool for you to go and invite someone to church. Okay, can we do that? Right, and I'm not asking you to do something I do not do. I promise. Everybody at Trader Joe's is probably sick of me handing them cards. Like, and bonds. They all know, oh, here she comes. I still haven't gone to church yet. Listen, my neighbors used to run inside the house when I would go and talk to them, ask my husband, because I was like, I'm going to get them to church. And you know what? After like, what, 3 years, 4 years, I finally got their daughter saved. And then she brought her brother, and then he got saved. And I was like, oh, you just wait. I'm going to get you saved. And I'm still praying for him. I might not live next door to him again, but I'm still praying for him. And you know what? I believe we're on a mission, guys, to see the name of Jesus expand, to grow in the hearts of people. As this world grows darker, you grow lighter. All right? So, dear God, we just commit to be full-time ministers, to be thankful, to do your will and your way this holiday season. God, I pray that you bless every Thanksgiving table around this room. God, that you bless every family, that you bless every person, that they would go into the highways and the byways and they compel men to your name, God, that they would stir the hearts of the people to your presence, God. Oh, Lord, I pray, God, that they would pray like they've never prayed before, that they dream dreams like they've never dreamed before, there'd be new visions upon them, God. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that there would be such an outpouring on the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, God, that you would just pour and open up the windows of heaven, God, that there would be such a blessing. And Lord, that you'd be honored this Christmas and know how much we love you in this Thanksgiving. Thank you, God, for your blessings. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.